Hi, in this video we'll focus on more complex material rendering. Specifically, we'll focus on anisotropy, a material aspect that can behave differently in different directions. You can think of it as adding directionality to the roughness. We'll start by discussing what Adobe standard material is and highlight key parameters of the anisotropic behavior. Then we'll delve into building an anisotropic metal material in Substance Designer and apply it onto models back in Stager. Adobe Standard Material, ASM in short, is a material model used in Adobe's 3D apps for physically based rendering. It ensures that materials created in any Adobe application, such as Substance 3D Designer, Painter, Sampler, or Stager, look the same. It also helps you achieve similar visuals in other apps using PBR rendering. In this video, we'll focus on the anisotropy parameters, which are essential for various surfaces such as metals and fabrics. In our case, we will create an anisotropic compact disc material with it. Anisotropic materials consist of properties with strong directionality. Anisotropy is responsible for the unequal spreading of light of a substance. Two parameters control the anisotropic effect. Let's check them out first. Anisotropy level defines how much the reflection is stretched. Anisotropy angle controls the rotation of the anisotropic effect. For accurate models, we have to use reference images while modeling. To render it properly in Stager later on, it's important to separate the parts which will have different materials from each other and to have an accurate centered UV map for the metal parts. For the anisotropic disc material, we have to go to Substance 3D Designer. We start with the ASM preset and get rid of the SSS and sheen outputs. Further, we delete the opacity, specular, and IOR outputs. We don't need those. Now, we change the uniform color nodes of the metallic and anisotropic level channel to white for a nice preview. To get the base of our anisotropic gradient, we add a gradient linear 2 node. A levels node is great to tweak the gradient transition further. Let's use a Cartesian to polar node to make it circular. Now we use a gradient map node and a reference image to sample the colors from. A HSL node is perfect to get more control over the colors later on. This helps for a more realistic result. Further, blend it with a light gray uniform color to have control over the color intensity and forward it to the base color output. To get the base for additional specular color details, we add a blend node. Let's use the gradient output as foreground, and when we later on change the hue, we have different specular edge colors. Specular edge colors are the color of light reflections at certain angles for metallic materials. To get some scratch details on top, we add a grunge scratches rough node to the coat normals and tweak the scratch tiling. Now we can expose the key parameters that we want to control in other software. Let's expose the hue, color blending, the grayscale color values for the roughness, metalness, anisotropy level, and coat opacity, and the coat normal intensity. I always make sure to name my exposed parameters properly. This makes it much easier to work with later on. If we wouldn't expose the controls for the anisotropy aspects here, they would be locked and unavailable in Stager. So whenever you want to control something in Stager, either expose the parameters or delete the inputs and outputs for that aspect. For simultaneous color intensity control, we use an empty function. Add the color gradient intensity float input and multiply it by 10. Let's add the multiplication node as output node and send it over to Substance 3D Stager by using send2. Back in Stager, our material appears right away in the material tab. We simply drag and drop it onto our main disk object to apply the material. Using send2 and ASM materials makes it very easy to jump between applications. We have all our exposed parameters available in Stager. Let's push the color gradient intensity. Now we focus on the anisotropy settings. With a combination of roughness and anisotropy level, we have great control over the anisotropic effect. We finally introduce a coat layer on top of it by increasing the coat opacity. This results in another layer with sharp reflections on top. For the translucent center part, we add a default material, reduce the roughness, and introduce some translucency. To achieve a nice product rendering, it is essential to have an accurate material setup, a good model, and proper lighting. The lighting especially helps to make the product look believable. You can either build a nice studio setup with physical lights, use a studio or outdoor environment light, or a combination of those. Experiment with different lighting setups to find the one that works best for your scene. In this case, I used a slightly rotated warm indoor environment light to achieve a warm lighting. I added a colorful gradient as camera background for a more vibrant look. As for the ground, I simply activated the ground plane in the environment tab. By adjusting the reflection opacity and reflection roughness sliders, I fine-tuned the balance between shadows and reflections. I hope we've clarified how to use anisotropy for your anisotropic surface materials and how to make your own advanced anisotropic materials. Good luck using it in your own projects!